as a graduate from Virginia Commonwealth University, where she received a bachelor's degree in parks, recreation, and sports management, with an emphasis in therapeutic recreation. She then went on to work as a certified therapeutic recreation specialist for individuals with special needs. In the summer, Beth will be pursuing a graduate, a doctorate of physical therapy at Virginia Commonwealth University Medical School. Beth is here this morning to share with us her personal account of encountering an illness at an early age and overcoming potential setbacks to push forward. She's accomplished many of her goals, including hiking from Georgia to Maine, the Appalachian Trail. So please welcome Beth.
Hello and good morning, everybody. I'm kind of going to sit up here a little bit. I just had hip surgery, so I don't want you guys to think I'm lazy or anything. But I want to thank you guys for having me here. First off, I want to thank Dr. Huber for finding my story a valuable one to come and share with you all. We originally had touch several years, or were in touch several years ago, so it's great to finally be here at this point to see you all. And second of all, I want to thank all of you guys for being here this morning, not only to listen to me, but I've kind of had an opportunity to see you guys work and get in your groove and do your thing this morning, and I hope to more so this afternoon or after the presentation. But you guys have a great thing going here, and I hope you guys really realize what you're doing and give yourselves a pat on the back. So thank you for doing what you're doing. It's awesome. So as Molly said, I am here to talk to you guys about overcoming an illness, as well as my journey along the Appalachian Trail and kind of how I got there. The Appalachian Trail, I wanted to make sure, I don't know if everybody knows what it is, but basically the Appalachian Trail is a hiking trail or a footpath that goes the length of Georgia to Maine. It's just pretty much for hikers. It's a network of trails, some of them linked together, and it estimates about 2,200 miles. So usually people set off on this for the whole duration, and it's usually about a 6-month expedition. And you're carrying everything that you need on your back and pretty much living in the woods. So if you guys don't know what it is, that's what it is. So you're setting out to live with Mother Nature. So in addition to talking about, or kind of the main point that I want to focus on here with you guys, and I hope walking away from my presentation, this is what you gain, is that I'm not here just to talk to you about myself and my story or the Appalachian Trail, but what I really want you guys to gain from this, and I think you guys realize it working with the children you're working with or maybe in your personal lives, is that we all encounter different obstacles in our lives. And I love the word that you were using as a challenge. So we all encounter these different challenges, and it's a matter of how we choose to overcome them. So we definitely have options of how we want to pursue or go beyond these perceived limitations or these challenges. All right, so as I'm going to start off here, I'm going to start pretty simply. Define disability. You guys obviously work in a field and work with children. You're seeing all sorts of stuff out there. And I think for us, I have some questions up here, as far as physical or cognitive limitations. I think that's the first thing that we typically tend to think of when we think of the term disability. And there's definitely other factors that, come into play. We can consider socioeconomic factors. Some people might consider disability your race or your gender. It also comes down to looking at cross-cultural type of things. Something in our culture that might not be a disabling factor in other cultures or other countries based on, again, socioeconomic status, as far as expenses of having a certain condition can be seen as more of a disabling factor. So the one type of disability that we're talking about is basically, in our culture, we look at it as something where it's a lack of control or the lack of ability to perform a certain activity. And I think that's probably, what we here see with as you guys are working with some of the children or what we kind of conclude to be in our culture. But there's another term that I wanted to use with you, I'm not used to this little clicky thing. So this is what I have up here, define disability. It's just the lack of ability to perform an activity. So there's two different types of disability that I like to keep in mind, and I learned this in my undergraduate program. You guys might have been exposed to it as well. So we have the actual absence of personal control, but there's something called a self-imposed disability. Have you guys ever heard of self-imposed or a learned helplessness? Do you guys know that term? You guys heard it? Nod of heads, maybe? No? Okay. Well, learned helplessness is... Here's my click. Okay. So basically is when a person learns to behave in a certain way because of a limitation that's possibly been placed upon them. So it's not necessarily because a person does not demonstrate the actual ability or have the skill to perform an activity. It's because potentially they've been restricted from performing in that way or restricted from obtaining that skill. I know personally, I saw it a lot when I worked as a therapeutic recreation specialist. We had individuals who couldn't count money or tie their shoes or didn't know how to cook or interact with their peers, not because they couldn't do it, but because maybe they lived, their caregiver never gave them that opportunity, or just assume that because they were diagnosed with MR that they would never reach that potential. So I wanted to bring this into this presentation is because I think, again, with a disability or with the term, you know, with somebody with a challenge, I think sometimes there's kind of that perceived limitation that I stated, that somebody might not be able to fulfill a certain aspect of their life because of what their diagnosis is or because of a certain condition that they're experiencing. So my perceived limitation or disability, and again, I love how Dr. Huber said challenge, is because what I have, I don't see as a disability. I know in some other countries it definitely is, again, because it requires a little bit more medical attention. And I know for a fact that in Russia, a lot of children who are born with the condition or have conditions similar to mine end up being put up for adoption. So there are different things that can occur, and that's why mine, can be perceived as a disability. I don't think it is so much in our culture, but mine is something called inflammatory bowel disease. And some of you guys sitting here might know exactly what this is firsthand. Some of you guys might have it. It's pretty common in our society these days. And basically, inflammatory bowel disease is something which is an autoimmune disease, and you guys probably know an autoimmune disease is when your body recognizes a healthy cell as kind of like an invader and attacks that healthy cell. So with inflammatory bowel disease, there's two different branches of it. There's one called ulcerative colitis and one called Crohn's disease. And basically, they subdivide it in these two categories because one, or they affect different part of the digestive system. So Crohn's can affect anywhere from your mouth to the anus, and the ulcerative colitis pretty much just affects your large intestines or your colon. So I'm gonna, if I use terms like that, I hope you guys don't feel awkward, but we're gonna get into the nitty gritty here. So, anyways, as you guys can read here with Crohn's, I put Crohn's, but it's for ulcerative colitis and Crohn's. These are some of the symptoms. So you basically get this inflammation of the tissue lining of the digestive system, and it can cause ulcers, which lead to bleeding, pain, severe diarrhea, weight loss, malnutrition, and abscesses. So like infections in the bowel that could become infected. So this is me, just my personal experience. I was diagnosed at an early age of 14. I was a freshman in high school. The term Crohn's disease was not unfamiliar for me. My mother was diagnosed in her early 20s, so it was kind of a household term that had been used. But I really didn't understand the implications of it. When the doctor told me, I thought, okay, I'm going to have to take these 16 pills every day, and I'll take them for the rest of my life, but I'll be okay. Well, unfortunately, my case was not like that. The symptoms continued to develop for me as I went through high school, and things got pretty bad. Started having a lot of pain, a lot of diarrhea. I was put on various medications, and every time I was put on something new, something failed, or it just continued to fail. If anything, I was having severe side effects from most of the medications. In some of these pictures, I actually have a wig on or a bandana. I actually lost my hair. I was on like heavy chemotherapy drugs, had severe weight gain, got the big moon face from steroids. I don't know if you guys have ever seen that. Severe insomnia. I wouldn't sleep for like several days. A lot of mood swings. And with this, it obviously led to an effect on my confidence and my esteem. And my senior year, I ended up being homebound because I was so ill. And I went into the hospital after numerous hospitalizations. I went in and they placed a central line in my arm. It's called a TPN line. And this fed into a vein into my heart, which I was hooked up to for 12 hours a day. And I received all my nutrition through that. So I was not eating anything by mouth for about 5 months. And I was just hooked up to an IV to receive my my nutrition. The reason that I went ahead and did that is because, again, none of the medications had worked for me at that point. And the hope was that by giving my digestive system complete rest and not letting anything pass through there, was that the tissue would be able to heal and I would be able to gain a state of remission. Well, unfortunately, it did not work. I was still having a lot of issues and I was in severe pain. At that point, again, I was homebound. I was in the hospital at least once every month or so. And I was having, you know, it was my senior year of high school, and I was socially limited. I had been a dancer. I was unable to dance anymore. Everything, as far as my life, had been drastically limited. So I knew I wanted to go off to college. You know, I wanted this great experience that you guys are having now. And where I was at that point, I knew I wouldn't be able to do it. So I met with my doctor, and I'm gonna click here. All right, so we started to discuss what's next. Every medication that was out there currently for my illness had not worked to bring me into a stage of remission. So we discussed the options of surgery. And I have up here this little picture. I don't know, have you any of you guys seen any of those, the image in the middle, any of those, it's a medical appliance. Has anybody ever seen one of those? Some of you I see nodding your head. Awesome. Okay. So basically, the doctors told me, they held up one of these bags and told me that I was going to have a procedure done in which I would need to wear a medical appliance comparable to that and have it attached to my abdomen for the rest of my life. And initially, upon being told that, I was just at the point where I was so drained. I was like, let's just do whatever we can. But basically, I have up here, it's kind of a joke, but the medical appliance that you guys see there, it's also the one that I currently wear, and I'm going to go into explain it a little bit more. But it's made by a company called Hollister. So you guys know the Hollister clothing company. And I don't know if any of you guys have actually gone online to do some shopping and typed in Hollister.com. You're not going to come up with the website that you think. It's actually going to be a wound care or ostomy care site. And the only fashion accessory you're going to find on there is those medical appliances. So be careful what you type into the internet, or you might want to try it now. So anyways, but these are just some little joke shirts because my friends and I who have ostomy bags will joke around, you know, if we're going somewhere, we'll be like, you make sure you got your bag, and, you know, it's always attached to us. So these just have, I don't know if you can read them, but the one says a bag that fits my lifestyle, and the other one says clothing that fits your bag. So I honestly wish I had one of those shirts, but I think somebody just posted them on the web for a joke. So the doctors told me, all right, we're going to perform this procedure. Basically, the procedure was we're going to remove your disease portion of your intestines or of your digestive system. And for me, that was my large intestines or my colon. And what they do then is since that connecting portion from your small bowel to your rectum is then lost, they create an opening in your abdomen and bring the portion of your bowel to the surface of your abdomen. And then you wear this medical appliance to the top of, or to the front of it, on top of it, excuse me. And that's where all your waste is then emptied. And as you can see, some of those are closed and there's different bags there. The one on the top right is basically for stool, and then the one on the left is typically for urine. It's got a small little type catheter type opening. So they told me I would be needing to wear that. So the next thing I want to go into is just kind of explaining the possibilities of surgery. You guys, again, I don't know, some of you guys might have friends or family members who have had similar procedures, or some of you guys professionally might experience it in the future working with different clients. So I just kind of want to break it down and explain some things you might run into. But the possibilities of surgery, so they told me that they were going to perform what's called a colectomy with a rectal Hartman. So that's basically, the colectomy is the removal of the large bowel, and the rectal Hartman is actually leaving the rectum intact. For my case, they left it intact with the possibility that in the future, if I was able to get into a stage of remission, that they could do something and actually connect my small bowel to my rectum so that I could actually excrete waste, as you know, most people do. So the second option here that they have is actually called a proctocolectomy, and that's the removal of the whole entire colon as well as the rectum. So they take everything out and sew it all up, so there's nothing there. We like to consider that a Barbie butt. So the next thing is called a J pouch, and so this is what they kind of left in the rectum for me as an option, is basically when they take the small bowel and they bring it down to the rectum, and they create a reservoir by folding the small bowel back upon itself and kind of cutting out the interior link there. And so it creates an area that you can temporarily store stool before needing to excrete it. All right, so now you guys are, I kind of led to, but you're asking probably, so where does this stool go? What does it exactly look like? So up here I have a diagram just to kind of give you guys a visual image of what someone with an ostomy, what they have. But basically an ostomy is the actual opening from where the waste exits the body, and the stoma is considered the piece of the intestine, or in some cases the ureter. Up here, as you guys are seeing on the right, you see a larger red piece, and that's actually the intestine, is what you'd see on an individual. And the one on the right is larger because that's actually a colostomy. So that, as you would imagine, is with the colon or the large bowel. So somebody would have a larger one for somebody with a colostomy. And on your left is somebody with an ileostomy, and so that's something that's inclusive of the small bowel that's brought to the surface of the abdomen. So you never see both of them at once, but just to kind of give you guys a visual image of what it looks like. So again, this is what I'm just saying as far as a colostomy. This kind of gives a visual image of what would happen if somebody was required to have a colostomy. So you still have part of the, I don't remember my medical terms here, is it the descending and transcending colon there? And then you have this, you know, medical appliance that's attached to it. And then an ileostomy, as you can see, there's the dotted part of the colon or the large bowel that was completely taken out. And so then you just have the terminal end of the small bowel that's brought to the surface of the abdomen, again, where the medical appliance is then attached to. And then we have the ureter, which this is for people who might have kidney issues or bladder issues. And this is, again, just kind of a diversion for them so that they can excrete their urine effectively. So I've explained to you guys that I have this ostomy because I've had Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis. It was kind of thrown up in the air at that point. But there's other individuals that might also encounter ostomies, and you guys might have already seen this. I don't know if any of the children you guys work with have them, or you might have seen. You do? Okay, very good. So, and some of you guys might even have friends or family members that have them, for all I know. So there's a variety of reasons. Spina bifida, I don't know if that's maybe the one who has the one here, but anyways, it's basically the individual with spina bifida, as you guys know, it's incomplete closure of the spinal canal. So that can lead to neurological impairments that affect bowel and bladder control. So for that reason, you might see somebody who has an ostomy. The next condition is called Hirschsprung's disease. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with this one, but basically it's a congenital condition when an infant is born without the nerve that actually controls the muscle contraction of the large bowel. And so at that point, they're given typically a colostomy so that basically, if they don't have the nerve and it's not contracting, they're unable to pass the waste, so they get obstructions or blockages. So they would be given a colostomy so that things can move through effectively. All right, the next condition is called diverticulitis, and that's when you get pouches that in the digestive system that are continuously infected and inflamed that can lead to severe infections needing that. The next thing is colon cancer. That's another one. Bladder cancer is where you'd see more of the urostomy. There's also something called bladder extrophy, which is kind of a congenital condition as well. There's another one, accidents or injuries resulting in bowel perforation. Not really something we'd all consider, but I know individuals who have been in car accidents who have had something perforate their abdomen, and therefore they've required medical need for an ostomy. You'll also see an individual is possibly with paralysis. Again, that's relating back to the nerve damage and inability to control bowel and bladder. And then bowel obstructions. A bowel obstruction is basically a blockage of the bowel. This can either result in actual twisting of the bowel to tie it almost like in a knot, or also if, again, just something, dehydration, it leads to, food getting lodged in there and eventually actually needing to be surgically removed. So now, my personal journey through surgery, as I said, they performed the colectomy with the rectal Hartman, so they left the rectum intact with the possibility of connecting it in the future. My personal view, the ostomy, again, at the beginning, I think there were some reservations knowing, again, I was 18 years old, there were reservations knowing that I was going to be changing my body image, being a young female. I mean, that's a huge thing. It's a huge thing for anybody, but I think more so when you're in high school and you're dealing with a lot of the different stereotypes of things. But I knew also at that point it was my option for health, and it was my option to regain an active lifestyle and be well again. So if anything, it was kind of a nice relief to know that there was something else we could do here. There are perceived stereotypes for ostomates, and I don't feel like they exist as strongly as they used to. I think a lot so because our medical technology has developed, so there's different appliances that are better developed to kind of help conceal it. But a lot of it is, as you guys would imagine, you're dealing with waste and you have it attached to your body to some sense. So there's a lot of perceptions that it's, there's going to be this large, very visible, smelly thing that's hanging from your body. I don't think I worried about it too much at that point going into the surgery. I was just too ill to really have any concerns. But then there was the big issue that eventually came for me, which was becoming well again. Didn't really think it would be an issue, but after I had my surgery, I went through kind of a euphoric point where I was able to start eating again. I hadn't eaten well for a long time, but I hadn't been able to eat at all for 5 months. I then headed off to college and moved out of state, went off to my freshman year of college, and was adjusting to this huge transition in my life. All of a sudden, I had this medical appliance. I was trying to cope with being healthy again. Nobody really knew about my condition going off to a new school. I started at that point, I think, to kind of realize as I started to feel better that, okay, I have this bag, like I have this thing hanging from me, and not only what do I think of it, but what do other people think of it? So it was a pretty big transition as far as dealing with my body image at that point, again, being 19 years old at that point. And then there were concerns for the future and kind of wondering what implications it was going to continue to have on my lifestyle. I was fresh out of surgery, so really wasn't sure, what it was going to bring for me. But eventually, I reached out for support. I was in a pretty low slump with it, so I reached out to a group called the United Ostomy Association of America. And as you guys would imagine, it's kind of like the American Cancer Society or something. So it's a support group. They provide services to individuals, no matter what condition brought them to it, but individuals who have ostomies. At that point, I was actually introduced to something called the Youth Rally, which is a camp for individuals for kids ages 7 to 18 who have ostomies. And at that point, I was like 19 or 20, so I was given the opportunity to work as a counselor at this camp. So this was really the changing point for me. Going into it, I had gone back to my surgeon and said, how can I get rid of this thing? Let's reconnect it. I don't want it anymore. What can we do? And I went to this camp, and I was dealing with seven-year-old kids running around with their ostomy bags about to explode because they were having so much fun. And, you know, peers my age who were just, you know, completely accepting of it, walking around in bikinis, you know, doing whatever. And then I had adults and mentors that I was looking up to in their 50s, 60s, 70s, who had lived with them since early ages when ostomies weren't that well known about or weren't that well accepted. And they were, you know, were serving as a role model showing what they had been through. So it was a huge changing point for me. I realized I literally was standing in front of the mirror one day with another female about my age, and we were comparing our ostomy sites. And I was just like, damn, I'm proud of this. This is something that defines me now. It doesn't run my life, but it's part of who I am, and it shaped me, and it took a lot of strength to get to the point where I was. So that was the first point where I really looked at it and thought, I'm not going to look at this as something that's a disabling factor for me anymore. I'm not going to want to change it, but I embraced it as who I was. So from this, I also developed quite a few friendships with other individuals, again, who had ostomies. And I met a certain individual who actually lived out west, and I had the opportunity to go visit this person. And we went camping and hiking and did all this great stuff that I had never done before, much less as an ostomate. So here I was digging cat holes, basically holes in the ground, to go to the bathroom with an ostomy, all this new stuff that I'd never done. Hiking out for beautiful views like this. This is out in Utah where we went. Just amazing. So I absolutely fell in love with the West, and I fell in love with the outdoors. And I decided at that point, I think I was a sophomore in college, I actually looked into trying to transfer out west. But anyways, I said, once I'm done with college, I'm moving out west. I'm hitting it. I'm getting to the mountains. So I decided that's where I wanted to be. So in fact, after I graduated college, I moved straight out to Denver, Boulder, Colorado area, got a job there. I spent every day. I didn't know a soul when I moved out there. So I spent every afternoon when I got off work hiking in the foothills and just exploring new trails, doing whatever I could. And on the weekends, I'd get up to the high country and explore larger peaks. Started to make friends, and I did rock climbing and just, you know, try to get outdoors as much as I could, did some backpacking. And I was, you know, I was enjoying life. It's a beautiful area. Everything, I seemed pretty content just doing what I was doing. So then I wasn't quite, here we go, okay. I wasn't quite at this point of deciding to hike the Appalachian Trail. And so now how did I get there? Well, like I said, I was pretty content just, you know, enjoying my weekend hikes up in the high country and doing whatever. But I had a few friends who would hike the Appalachian Trail. And again, as I explained it to you guys, it leads from Georgia to Maine. So I thought they say there's about 3,000 people that attempt to hike it each year, and maybe about 300 that actually complete it. And I don't really know if those statistics are so much true, but I feel like this might be a little bit more that complete it now. But anyways, I eventually just thought it was for crazy people. I was like, I know some of my friends, and they're pretty extreme. I don't think it's anything I'd ever really want to do. So basically one morning, I literally woke up in February 2007, and all of a sudden I had this crazy idea in my head that I was going to set out and be one of these crazy people. I was going to be one of those 300 or so people that actually hiked this whole distance of this trail. Unfortunately, at that time, I had my rectum that was still left intact, and it had continued to provide me a lot of difficulties over the years, and it had gotten to the point where my doctors were urging me, you need to have surgery and have this rectum removed. It was providing me a lot of pain and constant bleeding from the rectum because of the inflammation and because of the disease. So with this decision to hike the Appalachian Trail, I knew that I would also have to have surgery. It was something that I had put off for literally 5 years, despite my doctor's attempts to kindly convince me to have it done. And it was this decision to hike the Appalachian Trail that made me say, all right, I'm going to have this surgery. So Here we go. Here I am before my second surgery procedure. I have my nice little caution tape. I didn't want my doctor to give me some gnarly scar, so it says on there, do not cross this line. And then my ostomy bag there saying, handle with care. So I always thought it was pretty important, any medical procedure I had done, to go in with a pretty good attitude. And that kind of becomes one of my signature poses, so I'll strike for you guys. But all right, so exactly a month later, it was pretty a rush decision. I was like, all right, I'm going to hike the AT. All right, let's have surgery. Called my parents. I said, I'm having surgery in 3 weeks. You guys want to, you know, come out and take care of me? And so they had to drop everything, as good parents always do, and came out. I think my mom was there for probably like a month after my surgery taking care of me, because it was a pretty significant recovery. But eventually, I healed up. I spent the next year starting to go through all these things, kind of trying to figure out everything that I was going to need to do for this journey. So prior to actually hiking the trail, as far as my backpacking experience, I had hiked a lot, but as far as backpacking, I think I probably had like 10 or 12 trips under my belt, and I didn't start backpacking until I was about 21. So at that point I was 25, so I really didn't have that much backpacking experience at all. I had only done one overnight trip, and the longest trip I had done was 2 nights. And I was telling myself I was going to go out and spend 6 months in the woods. So, I mean, there's a pretty, you know, big jump there. The next thing was that I decided I was going to do it alone. I didn't have any friends that were quite willing to invest the time, or could they? And I wasn't quite willing to wait around. I knew it was something I wanted to do, and I was going to do it at that point. So decided I was going to go out by myself. The next thing was logistics of gear, food, and trying to kind of track my mileage and figure out where I was going to be. Gear, obviously, you guys don't want to be carrying 60, 70, 80 pounds on your back. I mean, it's great when you have a suitcase you can carry around the airport, but not when everything's on your back. So I was trying to get it down as lightweight, as minimal as possible. I literally had one outfit I wore every day and then something clean to change into at night. Didn't do laundry for like 7 days, so you're in the same dirty, stinky outfit every day. Food, I have some dietary restrictions, so I dehydrated and portioned out all my food, trying to estimate, you know, I'm going to need 3,000 calories every day, putting things in boxes, and estimating how many days it would take me to get from one town to the other. And again, kind mother here would ship things out to me. I'd call her and say, okay, in 6 days I'm going to be in this town, send out the box. So she would do that. The next thing was, can I really do this? Like, where did I get this crazy idea, and can I really do it? One of my friends who had hiked, the best advice he gave to me at that point, which didn't really make any sense to me at all, and I thought it was a little lame, but was, you have to really want to be there, is what he said. And I was like, well, that doesn't even make sense to me, but okay. So as I went on the trail, it did eventually make sense. Just some other things as far as hiking the trail, actually having an ostomy. It's one thing to go out and do it as your everyday person, but dealing with a medical condition. I had my family's concerns of, obviously, with my health issues, the risks of dehydration and leading to what I explained as the blockages or getting the obstructions in your bowel, and just, you know, any other family concerns, but particularly with the health issues at hand. I had to carry my medical supplies with me, so those appliances that you guys saw on that previous slide, I needed to make sure that I had ample supply of those that I was carrying with me throughout the journey. And again, having those shipped to me every few towns. My ostomy appliance, I typically change about every five or six days. So I needed to kind of estimate. I knew I was going to be much more active. And when you're much more active, the adhesive on there breaks down a lot more. So I needed to be carrying several just in case it was to leak, essentially. So I didn't want to run into that situation. Hygiene. I mean, you're out in the woods, your hands are dirty, dirty, dirty. Everything's dirty. And instead of changing my ostomy appliance and going to the bathroom and dealing with all of this, you know, with the nice porcelain white toilet and the running water from a sink, I was now out in the woods, you know, in my tent or sitting on a rock or doing, you know, whatever it was, wherever it was, whenever the occasion came. So again, as I mentioned, the elements with the humidity and the heat and the rain, the ostomy appliances break down much quicker. So that was something I had to take into consideration. And the bathroom, again, no flush toilets out there. If you're, I would say if you're fortunate, you get a outhouse, but a lot of times I'd walk right by those because they're not the prettiest sight to be seen. And a lot of other times you're digging your own hole in the ground, and that's where you're going to the bathroom. And again, if you know, for some people, if you're going once a day or once every few days, it's not a big deal. With an ileostomy, pretty much anything I eat within a few hours is draining out of me. Like, it's just constantly moving through. So I'm going to the bathroom much more than the average person, per se. All right, so this is just some pictures here of prior to the trail and getting started. As you can see in the top right, that's kind of what a whole bedroom looked like, of getting food and getting gear and supplies and everything stocked up. That's just kind of me on a little prep hike, just testing it out. The Appalachian Trail is marked by white blazes, so every few hundred yards or something, you see a white blaze to make sure you know you're on the correct trail. Down here is kind of my guidebook, broken out into different stages that I had shipped out to me, and you can see some boxes back there geared up with some stuff on them. And then there I am kind of doing my signature pose. I like to get animated. Getting ready to head out on the trail somewhat, not in my blue jeans though. All right, so one other thing before I headed out on the trail, and I didn't tell Dr. Huber and Molly this last night. I was waiting for the presentation today, but on the trail, everybody gets a trail name. And typically, you acquire it on the trail by something humorous you do or something that marks your character. I ultimately came to the conclusion that my trail name would have been Soggy Bottom if I did not choose my own, because on the first day, it was raining, and my rain suit did not provide any protection, and my whole butt was completely drenched. And so they tried to name me Soggy Bottom, but fortunately enough, I had this name already. So if you guys don't know, this is a lotus flower, and I chose my name to be Lotus. It's far less entertaining than a lot of the other names out there, but I chose this name because I wanted something that was meaningful. I had made this decision to go through this second surgery, and I had also had, you know, a pretty extensive medical history and places and things that I had to get through. So when I was out there introducing myself to people or writing in these trail journals along the way, I wanted to sign my name or state my name with something that I had a lot of confidence in, something that really meant something. And if you guys don't know what Lotus means, it's basically, it kind of expresses self-confidence. To me, I always give the definition of infinite or new beginnings and infinite potential is what it means. So I thought it was very appropriate to what I was setting out there to do. Again, I had undergone this second surgery and was setting off, you know, for infinite potential. So here we go. Where am I? I don't even know where to click this thing. Okay, so this is the journey as it begins. This is me at the beginning of the trailhead. I started on March 15th of 2008. And as you can see here, it's pretty foggy. Actually, that day, as we were sitting in the hotel room that morning, there were floods in downtown Atlanta. And I was starting in Georgia, just kind of like an hour northwest of Atlanta, Georgia. So there was like torrential weather going on. And I'm sitting there like eating my breakfast, getting sick to my stomach, watching it, thinking I'm starting in this weather. But this is basically the beginning. And what I didn't realize at this point, as you can see, I have the nervous smile on my face, was that this journey ultimately was gonna have a much more symbolic representation than I initially thought. But what I come to in the conclusion, and you guys will kind of see it throughout here, the slides, is that the journey along the trail very concretely symbolizes your journey through life in very concrete ways. So as you guys will see here, click it that way, now I see it. Okay, so this is when I started off. I had a friend hike with me for like the first 3 days. And as you guys can see, the weather is pretty ugly. It was thundering and lightning and hailing. And as I said, there were floods nearby. And so at this point, I think my teeth were probably chattering, but I figured it can't get any worse. You know, if I'm starting off in this weather, and if I can make it through it, then I'm bound to be able to get through the rest of it. How awful can it get? So headed off on the trail this day, and so had a lot of rain, but then fortunately, you know, a few days later, we were greeted with some days where it was pretty sunny out, and as you can tell, I'm feeling strong again. The beginning of the trail was very comparable, I came to, of starting college, actually. You're with this large group of individuals. You're all kind of in the same place. You're excited because you know this new journey awaits you, but you're all kind of nervous because you don't really know anybody. You don't really know what's going on. But there's kind of this understood ground where you guys can relate to each other because you're all in the same position. So that's how it was. Again, I said about 3,000 people attempt to try it each year. Not everybody starts at the same time, but the day I started, there were probably about 40 people starting that day at the first shelter. So you kind of start seeing a lot of people in the beginning, and everybody, you know, is comparing pack weight and, you know, trying to talk mileage and figure it all out, figure out what they're doing. So, but it was this new adventure that was awaiting me. So here I am. This is actually in North Carolina. And again, we were greeted with a sunny day, which was great and not very frequent. When we were in the beginning, it was pretty foggy, as you can see. So again, some days are going to be cloudy and some days you'll feel weak. So this is me in a dingy shelter one evening after a pretty rainy day, I think, of hiking. That evening, I actually got up to use the restroom when it was dark out, and it was so foggy that with my headlamp reflecting, I got lost. Like, I didn't know where I was. So it can turn you around a little bit. But yeah, so that's kind of what you're living in for 6 months. It's just these little shelters or your tent. But in the beginning, we had, like I said, we had a lot of fog and rain. I started in March in the mountains, and so you can definitely still get cold weather. We had some nights below freezing temperatures, a little bit of snow, not a whole lot. Fortunately, we didn't get that much that year. But I mean, there were nights in the low teens, and yeah, again, all you have is what's on your back. So if it's 13 degrees out and you know, you got all your clothes on and you're still freezing cold in your sleeping bag, chances are it's going to be a pretty sleepless night. And we definitely had some of those. But again, everybody else is going through it, so you look for support from other people, and then you get rewarded by those sunny days that I showed before, and so it helps you get through it. So there were also days where you may feel lost. Here's some of my other fellow hikers. Again, you have people of all ages. I was 25 or 26 at that time. And here are some other individuals. I'm not sure exactly how old they are, but they're out there hiking it too, and they became very good friends of mine. The gentleman in the front, his name is Gentleman Jack. And then the woman in the middle, her name is Willow, and the gentleman in the back, his name is Thinker. So just to kind of give you guys some ideas of some other trail names too. So at this point, it's the first few weeks into the trail. We were in the Smoky Mountains down in Georgia at that point. And at this point, everybody's feeling the wear and tear on your body because, you know, you've gone from not hiking at all to all of a sudden hiking 15 miles a day or more or less, depending on who you are. But your body is adjusting. So you have a lot of people with, you know, feet problems, blisters, a lot of knee problems. At that point, you have a lot of people who have already dropped off the trail. They decide it's not what they want to do, and they're, you know, already caught the airplane or bus home or whatever. So you're already seeing a lot of people leave at that point. You're also seeing, like I said, people are comparing gear, people are comparing miles, and you're feeling this stress. You have 6 months to hike all the way up to Maine, and you're feeling this stress of, I need to hike like 30 miles today. Like, I'm never going to get there. So you're feeling this pressure, and you also have other people, you know, who want to out hike, and it's still kind of this rat race, I think I compare to life, of people trying, you know, to compete. And it's, you ultimately just have to remember that you want to hike, you have to hike your own hike. You know, you're there for your own reasons, and you need to do what you need to do. And again, I think that's something that we can relate to our lives. We all have our own goals, and you guys, you know, we all just need to keep in perspective. Just do what you can do, because you ultimately know what's best for you. So about 2 weeks into the hike, this is something I kind of decided whether I was or was not going to share, but about 2 weeks into the hike, I started having a lot of foot pain. As I said, people were experiencing a lot of different aches and pains, and I thought, all right, well, I'm hiking a lot more, whatever, I'll just kind of brush it off. Well, about 5 weeks in, it was to the point where I was crying every night just because it was excruciating. I couldn't sleep because anyway, my foot brushed against my sleeping bag. I was in excruciating pain. And I finally had my mom call a doctor somewhere off the trail and was able to get a few different people to like hitch rides and kind of get me over to this doctor's and went to an orthopedic doctor and had an x-ray done on my foot. And they told me that my foot was broken and I had fractured my foot and I needed to hang up my hiking shoes and go home and kind of give up the dream. And here I am devastated. I'm like, I've done everything. I put my, you know, I moved away from Colorado. I quit my job. I went through this surgery. I've done everything for this goal of mine. There's no way I'm going home. You have to be kidding me. But unfortunately, I did. I went home, and that's the end of it. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, you guys thought I really hiked, didn't you? No. I went home, and I spent 4 weeks at home, absolutely miserable and depressed at my parents' house. My mom can probably talk about that if you want to hear about it. But even just in 5 weeks, I had been changed. I mean, I was mountain girl. I didn't want to have anything to do with society. So I went back for 4 weeks to my parents' house and rested my foot. I was in a walking boot for 4 weeks, just rode the bike every day just to try to keep up my endurance. And the doctors told me at least 8 weeks in the walking boot. I said, well, I'll try 4, and then I'm getting back out there. So because I knew if I wanted to keep going north, I had to do it by a certain point to beat the weather. So at 4 weeks, I went back on the trail and just prayed to God that my foot was going to make it through. Well, fortunately, it did. So again, I was just so grateful at that point. I think even more so than the first 5 weeks I was out there, I realized how lucky I was to have this second opportunity. And if I could make it, I swore I would appreciate every single day more than anybody else out there because, again, I had this second chance to be able to do what I wanted to do. So here I am just enjoying some of the beautiful views. Again, fortunately, a sunny day. And this here is kind of the mental halfway point in West Virginia. And this was basically in the midst of the heat and the humidity of the summer. I know you guys get some humidity up here, but it's not as bad as the South, probably, as we were discussing last night. And it was pretty miserable at this point. Between mosquitoes and no-see-ums, I was probably covered head to toe in bug bites. And when you're sleeping at night in 100 degree weather and humidity and all those bug bites are itching, it's pretty unpleasant. I don't think I have a picture of it, but there was one day I actually had on my long johns, my rain gear, and was in my 15 degree bag, which means it's rated to keep you warm to 15 degrees. And it was probably 110 degrees out. And I was just trying to get away from the bugs because they were attacking me viciously. And so I was basically creating a sauna for myself within a sauna just to try to get away from the bugs. So you had days like that. They weren't all pretty. You can't get some of those elements in the pictures here. But this is at the AT headquarters in Harpers Ferry, West Virginia. So it's the big check-in point. Everybody checks in. You get your picture taken at this sign. And so it's kind of an honor just to make it at least to this point as well. All right. And so celebration. Again, as I was saying, there's some days that are really challenging. And whether, you know, no matter what it was, even if it was the most challenging day, it's always seemed that there was some reward from the journey that day. And whether it was making a new friend, maybe another hiker, maybe having somebody from off the trail who helped you out, there was also like enjoying views like this. You know, you might be in, we call it the green tunnel on the trail because you're pretty much, you're on the East Coast. It's a lot of trees. Which can kind of get defeating after a while in its own way, and then you come upon a view, and you can sit there and, you know, have some refreshing water. Maybe there's a good water source nearby, and it's really rewarding. The one thing I wanted to mention to you guys is on the trail, there's hikers, but there's also people that we call trail angels and something we call trail magic. So basically, a trail angel is an individual who is out there to support hikers, whether they intentionally go out to actually offer, you know, rides into town. Some people will actually set up like camp at a road crossing and have, you know, coolers and maybe their you know, their grill set up, and they'll feed hikers as they go by. I had trail angels who offered for me to come and stay in their home for a day or two where I could, you know, get some good rest and shower up, and they would feed me well. And then there's trail magic, and that's kind of, there's two different types of trail magic. There's trail magic when you're walking along the trail and you find a big cooler where somebody stocked it out there with, like, nice cold drinks and food. Or there's trail magic if like something on your pack is broken and you're walking down the trail and you find like that buckle piece just laying there on the ground. So it's kind of the luck of the draw or the, you know, good nature of whatever spirit's out there helping you out. So you get a lot of those. On your hard days, you get rewarded by trail magic too. It always seems to appear right at your time of need if you're having a really hard day. All right. Just going through here, some more pictures. So it's not all mountains hiking along the trail. This was maybe Maryland, Pennsylvania, I'm not sure. Going through a lot of weeds and tall grass. Down here, that was definitely Pennsylvania, but you're walking through, you know, walking under electric wires, walking by farms, whatever. Pennsylvania was really bad for ticks and cicadas and caterpillars and rocks. There was a lot of bad things about Pennsylvania. We had the cicadas or the locusts. I'm not sure which ones they were, but I don't know if you guys are familiar with those, how they make the really high squealing noises. And I guess they come out however many years, but they were coming out in this area. There were holes all over the ground, and you could just hear them constantly ringing in your ear all day. Well, to make it even better, they would just like dive bomb into you as you were hiking, so they would be flying into you everywhere. Then there were caterpillars everywhere. It felt like fall in some areas because there was no foliage on the trees because the caterpillars had completely eaten off all of the leaves. So needless to say, the caterpillars were everywhere, which meant you were inevitably stepping on them or setting your pack in them and ended up with their goop all over you. At night, it would sound like it was raining, but it was really just the caterpillar pellets falling out of the trees. So that was pretty interesting. What else? Oh, the ticks. One day, you always had to do tick checks. We had some people that actually got Lyme's disease while they were out there, but you're chronically doing tick checks several times throughout the day. One day, I think I got about 9 or 10 ticks that I had on me that I ended up having to get off. So you're walking through a lot of stuff like that, and they're bound to get on you. So you need to check everything. So let's see what we got next. Just some rock scrambles going through here. And this was down in New Jersey. New Jersey has a very high bear concentration. I have my most memorable story from New Jersey where I actually had a bear run off with my food. So to make a long story somewhat short, ended up camping with a group of individuals that evening. And we, at night, you typically throw a rope up over a tree and you hang your food from that rope and you tie it off. And that keeps the bears from, you know, being able to get at your food, because there's definitely bears all along the trail, particularly so in New Jersey. Well, the one evening I was with about 5 other people, and there were no good trees to hang up our food from. So we found one branch eventually, and we all decided to hang our food from it. Well, the next morning, the one gentleman was awake before the rest of us, left all of our food down, and he went off to hike for the rest of the day. Well, we woke up and for some reason happened to wake up at the exact point when this bear was trotting up the mountain with a food bag in his mouth, and to which we discovered was mine. Well, it was the heat of the summer, not to embarrass myself, but I was not wearing that many clothes at that point because it was so hot and I was in my own tent. And I'm seeing this bear running up the side of a mountain with my food, which was my nourishment for the next few days. And needless to say, I freaked out. So I started running up off the trail or up the side of the mountain with whatever I had on me or what I didn't have on me. And after this bear, like I thought I was gonna be able to get my food back. I don't know. or like he was gonna stop and surrender. But eventually, I couldn't find him. I was pissed. I came back, packed up my stuff. I have a friend named Creek Diver who went after the bear and did find my food. He was sitting there eating my peanut butter, which I love peanut butter, so I was pretty mad about that. And we got it back, but there was maybe like one thing in there that had not been slobbered on. It was disgusting. Well, the bear came back as we were trying to pack up, and let's just say that was an interesting story of trying to keep. It was a game of charge both ways while we were trying to pack up. He was trying to intimidate us, and we were trying to intimidate him, and eventually got out of there. So a lot of interesting encounters on the trail. Makes for a memorable story now, but that day I was pretty mad. So, all right, so here we're going through some more stuff. Again, this picture, I think it was from New York. It does not look bad there. Nobody talks about New York, but it was. I don't know if it was just the time of year that we were there, but it was a lot of rocks, a lot of very, very slick rocks, very moist rocks, these don't look like that at all. I should have gotten a better picture. But we actually had a gentleman who fell and broke his leg in New York. Pretty bad situation, doing 20 mile plus days at that point. So pretty exhausting. I even took pictures and video of myself hiking down the trail, like crying, you know, and making little memos to friends back at home saying like, you think this is a vacation, this is miserable, you know. So there were hard and challenging days. But at this point I was starting to think of what my friend had said, and it was, you have to really want to be there. You know, there's so many good things that I knew that awaited ahead. And I think the same is in life. There's so many good that awaits ahead that you have to want to be there and pull through those difficult times in order to see the good that are coming ahead. So, some more pictures here. There's a lot of swamps, at this point too. So you're walking around marshy areas. Actually, shortly after this top picture on the right, we walked by a nudist colony. Fortunately, didn't see anybody out, but they were having a picnic a few days later, so I feel sorry for whatever hikers did walk by at that point. So here we go. We just have some more pictures. These are a lot of guys on the trail. The majority of the hikers are guys. The girls that you typically do find are typically like with a boyfriend. It's not many solo girls you find out there. At this point in Pennsylvania and on upward, I hiked with several girls. I told you there was a girl creek diver who got my food. The girl on the right is shelter monkey, and on the left we have snake whisperer. And so they became very good friends of mine, and it was great all of a sudden to have these females hiking with again. This was at an old hydroelectric plant. We happened to see this faucet, you know, head on the side of it and decided it was a great opportunity to clean up. So we literally pulled out our soap. I mean, you're honestly showering every week if you're lucky, that's it. And again, you're in the same clothes every day in 100 degree weather. So we were taking the opportunity to shower up on the side of this little hydroelectric plant here. All right, so again, as I was saying, there's a lot of challenges when you're out there. And again, as in life, everybody's challenges are different. Somebody's good day can be somebody's bad day, and somebody's bad day can be somebody's good day. So you're always there to support each other. At this point, you know, I'm not even thinking about it, presenting it to you guys, but I had an ostomy. Wasn't that big of a deal. Nobody really knew about it that I hiked with, because I never really made a point to make a point about it. I mean, it was part of me, but I didn't need to go out of my way to say anything about it. With the weather, as I was explaining earlier, the adhesives on my ostomy appliance started to break down a lot. So I started to have a lot of issues where they would leak throughout the day. You know, as I said, I would normally change it every 5 to 6 days. I had times where I was changing it twice a day because it was leaking. This day, we were doing like a 24-mile day. Bugs were eating us alive. I had my ostomy appliance leak in the morning, had it leak again that afternoon. I got to this road crossing. It was just like a gravel forest road, and it was leaking. I literally threw down my pack and sat there and cried for probably about 30 minutes. I was just beat up. I was kind of pissed at that point that I was having to deal. You know, it was kind of one of those pity moments, like, I'm having to deal with so much more than anybody else. But and I refused to. I was like, I'm not touching it. I'm just going to sit here for the rest of the day. I was expecting like some good fortune to come across and like do something magical for me. I just didn't want to have to deal with it. But eventually I did. So at this point, I think this is the only picture I ever got of me dealing with an ostomy on the trail. But I think it was just a very memorable day for me in that sense. So I did. Again, you guys are seeing just some gravel along this side of it was just like a little road crossing. And I have some of my medical appliances out there. That's my hydration pack, and that's where I, you know, was taking my water to help clean everything. And then that's obviously my stomach with my medical appliance kind of in full view just to see it. So kind of gives you guys a little bit of a clearer picture of what I was dealing with out there. I guess the next thing I want to say about this is, you know, I finally picked myself up literally from my pity party. Well, as soon as I got right back on the trail, with like 5 steps into it, I tripped on a rock, and I had not fastened my backpack on quite enough at that point. So the point where I tripped and I had my backpack slam my head into a rock, and it like scalped the top of my head. I bruised like both of my elbows. My knee instantly started to swell. I got up with like tears swelling in my eyes to the point where I couldn't even see, and I just kept walking on. I was like, I'm not even going to think about it. So again, just having to keep on pick yourself up, you know, no matter what happens. All right, so here I am with here's a bunch of hikers and I at a nice little ice cream stop somewhere along the trail. Again, like I was saying, a lot of camaraderie among, you know, friends out there. I also knew I constantly had support of friends back home, which was really helping me get through this. And let's see. Okay. Just some other pictures here along the trail, just to give you guys a view. Let's see what else we got. This was the 28 days of rain that began in Vermont. As you can see, this was a pretty common picture of my foot at that point. And just the sky, just to give you guys some stuff. This is a picture of trail magic. As I said, somebody had set this up outside their house in New Hampshire there. And then this is us just dealing with more rain in the whites. This is more rain in the whites, pretty slippery and slick conditions that we had going through there. It was definitely scary. We had a lot of people dislocating shoulders, breaking wrists, a lot of injuries with those conditions. So, but that is the whites up in New Hampshire. What do we got? Some more trail magic up here on the left. Gorged ourselves when we came across that type of stuff. So at this point, again, was feeling pretty depleted. And I think right around the same day, we had this great trail magic provided by this crew of people, and the clouds started to lift in the white. So we started to actually get some views, which was pretty incredible. There's a nice little picture of my feet there, just to let you guys know that they got pretty pruny and stuff, hiking in the constant rain and wet conditions. But yeah, just dealing with more of the amazing views. As you can tell, I think the endorphins had kind of kicked back in at this point as we were in the White Mountains, and it was just absolutely breathtaking and beautiful. And I know Dr. Huber has been there, so he can share a lot of stories. At this point, we were winding down. We entered into Maine, which was just stunning. But at this point, it was a huge reflection, again, on kind of what the experiences have been. Knew we were wrapping it up, getting to the end of our journey. And you're reflecting a lot about, you know, what you had conquered and the friendships you had made, and kind of also thinking about what was next for you. So just some more pictures going through there. And this is pretty much the end. This is the last day where I hiked up the last mountain with a lot of mixed feelings. You know, your body's fatigued and exhausted, and you're ready to be done in one sense, but in another sense, you don't want the journey to be over because it's completely transformed you and it's become your way of life. So, and this is just kind of the people that I summited with on that day on Mount Katahdin up in Baxter, Maine. So, and so this is everybody takes their picture at Katahdin. And I had this planned out pretty early on that this was going to be my summit picture. So there I am again with my ostomy bag. And then I actually plastered one to the Katahdin sign, which people do all sorts of stuff on the Katahdin sign. But that was my picture for, you know, my summit photo, just to kind of, again, symbolize what I had gone through and what I had literally carried with me the whole way. A lot of people didn't even know I had an ostomy until that point, where I smacked it right up there on the sign and whipped this thing out in front of them. And so, but for me, it was huge. So there's that. So just to kind of wrap it up, basically, again, in life, you know, we're all faced with different challenges. Dr. Huber uses a word, not necessarily a disability, but different challenges. Everybody sitting here, unless you're extremely lucky, all of you guys have faced them too. So we have the two options. You know, we can either give up or you can get going. And different things happen, whether it's a disability or whatever it is, but there's really no limit to what you guys can experience. And you guys are proving that right now with the children that you're working with. You guys are proving it now being here today with what you guys are doing in college and what you're getting ready to pursue for your future. So it's a matter of you guys remembering that for yourselves and supporting those that are your friends or your families or your clients or whoever it is that you're working with, to also offer them the same encouragement to do the same. So like I said, and my friend said, and I think now we can all kind of relate to a little bit more, is you really have to have the desire to want to be there. You have to have the desire to actively participate in life. You know, it's what you make of it. So I hope you guys will take that into hold, and I hope you gather that from today. So go blaze your own trail, y'all.
Take one question. Who wants the fire at that? The question. Go.
Would you do it again?
Yes. I just had hip surgery, and I'm hoping that my hip will allow me to do something like that again. Yes, definitely. And I encourage any of you guys to do it. I mean, it's life-changing, definitely. You'll never look at things the same. So if you like hiking, or even if you don't, I knew people who had never hiked a day in their life who went out there and did it. So
well, you guys are right.